All right, so name of the reading is Corporate Governance and Environment, Social and Governance, which is typically referred to as ESG. This is a new reading in 2017 CFA Level 1 curriculum. So generally in my experience, a reading which is newly introduced might have a higher probability of being tested on the exam. So that's one. Second, this is the type of reading that CFA Institute really loves. So they kind of really like readings on stuff like ethics or corporate governance, so which means it gives us all the more higher probability. And the topic is quite interesting as well. So think of it this way. You want to start a new business. Okay, so that new business can take a legal form of an individual proprietor. Proprietor means one individual running the entire business. Or you can set up a partnership, correct? Or you can set up a limited liability partnership, which is a form of partnership. Or of course you can go with a company format. Okay. Is anyone of you or your relative doing a proprietorship business? You're doing a proprietorship business. Your father is doing a proprietorship business. Okay. So does he go to the business every day? Does he recruit, fire employees? Does he take decisions? Okay. So that means that proprietor has a good control on the business. Owner has a control. Anyone has relative or himself doing a partnership business here? No. Okay. So even in a partnership, those partners will have a right. They can go to the firm. They can take decisions, strategic decisions, recruitment decisions, financial decisions. Now, has any one of you invested into stock markets, equity shares? No? Okay. Let's assume that you buy shares of a listed company. Okay. Let's say a company like L&T in India. It's an infrastructure space company. Now, if I am the shareholder of this particular company, can I say I am one of the owners of the company? Yes or no? Yes. So then if I am one of the owners of the company, can I go to that company today and fire a few employees? No. Why? It depends on the kind of stock that I hold has voting rights or not. So my stock has voting rights. Can I go and fire a few employees today? I have, let's say, 1 million rupees worth of shares, which is 0.0001% of the company. So no, I don't have the right. So now see the difference here, that in a company, it is not the owners who are managing the business. These owners recruit board of directors. Board of directors in turn recruit management and they manage the business. What this creates in finance, we call it as an agency issue. Okay, so an agency issue is that on behalf of me, I being the owner, we have appointed board of directors. We will expect those board of directors and management to work in the best interest of the shareholders. Correct? So they are in a way our agents and I am the principal, or we are the owners are the principal. So how do you ensure that those agents are working in the best interest of the principal? Okay, that is what we would essentially be dealing under the area of corporate governance. Okay, now in the last few years, corporate governance has become very popular. Okay, so in a very nutshell, how you think of corporate governance is whether company is doing business ethically, whether management is working in the best interest of the shareholder. More or less, this is what corporate governance is. Now, after 2008 and after Enron and after so many cases that have happened in US, Indian markets, today investors give a lot of importance while picking up a stock. They ensure that corporate governance is on the top of their checklist while evaluating a stock. Okay, and today we will understand in this reading that what kind of practices are considered good corporate governance and what kind of practices are considered negative corporate governance. Are we okay? So again, my approach is going to be learning outcome. Strategy for the reading, make sure that you write down all the important pieces that I asked you to today, and then we are more or less done with the reading. Okay, so these are the learning outcomes. We have a long list. First learning outcome, definition of corporate governance. This is learning outcome A, definition of corporate governance. Now be with me on this one. Now, this definition we have picked up directly from one of the CFA Institute publication, which is called Corporate Governance of Listed Companies, a Manual for Investors. Okay, now observe carefully. Corporate governance is described as system of internal controls. Can you tell me what is this? Internal controls? Within the company, a system of checks and balances. Correct. For example, an easiest way to think is you're going for a movie, so you buy tickets at the counter. Then when you're entering the movie hall, there is someone who's going to check the tickets. Then you enter the cinema hall, there is one more person assisting you to sit at the appropriate place. So there's a system of checks and balances. Correct. You go to a food mall, you buy coupons, and then you go to the appropriate place and order your food. So internal controls and procedures by which individual companies are managed. Okay, so roughly this is how they've defined corporate governance. It provides a framework that defines rights, roles, and responsibilities of different groups within the organization. So who could be these groups? These groups could be your employees, they could be your customers, your suppliers, shareholders, management. At its core, corporate governance is arrangements of checks, balances, and incentives a company needs in order to minimize and manage conflicting interests between insiders and external share owners. Now, what I want you to write is this. First thing you would write is system of checks and balances. System of checks and balances to minimize and manage conflicting interests between insiders and external share owners. You are going to double underline the word conflicting, or in fact conflicting interest. Okay, this is more or less the theme of the reading. So if I'm a shareholder and you guys are bondholders, not necessary that what is my best interest is same your best interest. Not necessary our best interests are aligned with each other. So how do you manage that conflict is your corporate governance. Okay. Now they've given two theories here. The first one you're going to give heading shareholder theory. Shareholder theory, and then leave a couple of lines and below that write down stakeholder theory. Okay, so in a shareholder versus stakeholder. So there are two broad ways of thinking at these theories. What shareholder theory says is that a corporate governance should be directed to maximize shareholders' wealth. Okay, so you should take decisions in such a fashion that ultimate beneficiary of those decisions is going to be shareholder. What stakeholder theory says is not necessary. You should be able to balance the interest between all of the stakeholders. So who are the stakeholders? Starting with shareholders, then bondholders, the ones who have given debt to the company, then suppliers, customers, employees, and government. Okay, so these are, and this is not an exhaustive list, these are the stakeholders. So shareholder theory says just work in the best interest of the shareholders, whereas stakeholder theory says try to manage between all the different stakeholders of the business. Are we okay with this? So you can write this quickly. Next learning outcome, a company's stakeholder groups and interest of each of the stakeholder groups. So we'll have a look at similar list of stakeholder groups now. Number one, shareholders, their interest is that company should, this you need not write, it's repetition. So shareholders, their interest is what? Maximization of their wealth, which happens when the company is making profits. Then board of directors. Okay, so these are the representatives appointed by the shareholders to manage the business. Senior management, who are appointed by board of directors. Then employees, creditors, suppliers. This is a comprehensive list of all the possible stakeholders.